Welcome to the Leading Hope Podcast with Kevin Jack. Your influence will lead people somewhere, lead them towards hope. Everyone has 20 minutes to learn to become a better leader. Make it count.
Welcome to Leading Hope with Kevin Jack. I'm your host, VJ Williams, here with my friend and pastor, Kevin Jack. Thank you for joining us and taking time out of your day to become a better leader. We will release a new episode every Wednesday, so we'd love for you to subscribe, share on social media, and bring others along with us on this journey of becoming a better leader. Visit leadinghope.online to get updates and find out more about the Leading Hope community. Today we are episode 12, Find Some Rhythms. Yeah, let's find them.
So this is the last episode in our focus on rhythms. So as we've talked about all these different things as it relates to rhythms, of having your ensuring your rhythms are not just observed and absorbed, but designed, of ensuring that you are cultivating the rhythms in your life, of ensuring that you are thinking like an architect and not just living a haphazard life that was handed to you. On this episode, what we want to do is we want to show you a bunch of different rhythms. And I just want to take you through a bunch of different rhythms in my life. Some for you to adopt. Some of these you're going to go, oh, I need to do that. Others of these you're going to go, nope, no thank you. One of the things I do when I get with great leaders, one of the questions I always want to ask is I just want to go, hey, what's your typical week look like?
Yeah.
How are you setting yourself up for success? And I've learned so many different things over the years in terms of not just what they do, but how they think about what they do that has been so beneficial for me. So I just kind of want to offer up a lot of these things to you and take some, use some. Others you can think are crazy and you go, nope, that's not me, not at all. That's perfectly fine with you. But maybe the most important thing that I can communicate throughout this is not simply some rhythms you can have in your life, but the fact that they're intentional, that they're purposeful, that I know what they are and why I'm doing what I'm doing. So first, I want to take you through some personal rhythms I have, and then we'll walk through some organizational and some family rhythms. So I kind of have a series of four different things. So every year, I take a three-day retreat, whatever, however you want to call it, time for personal planning. This is an opportunity for me to look at the previous year and go, what happened this year? What worked? What didn't work? What are the things that I intentionally did? What are the things that I unintentionally did? What would I do the same? What would I do different? Just those high level questions. For me, I do it in November. I do it on the heels of our staff planning session, because for our staff, we have taken some time to get away and to kind of map out the next year. And so that sets a focus for me and going, okay, so what do I need to become? What do I need to do different? How do I need to set up my personal schedule for our church to continue to move forward as well? So I have an annual time to do personal planning. I every month take 3 hours to set my schedule, to define key work, and to make sure I'm proactive. So I have an annual rhythm that's about 3 days. I have a monthly rhythm that for me, honestly, it's just 3 hours. And I know many friends and pastors and leaders who take a lot more time than that for a month. For me, I just need about 3 hours and just going. One of the things that I want to be sure is that I am spending time with people face to face to learn from them. And that's one of the biggest things I do at that month time is I schedule out lunches and coffees, because I know within the rush of my week that will always get neglected. So I set those out a month at a time to make sure those spots are filled with a chance for me to grow and develop. Every week, I take about 30 minutes. And for me, these weren't all designed with threes. I just want to be clear on that. That's just literally the time that's taken. It's not like I was intentional about that. Every week I take about 30 minutes and I do kind of do an evaluation of the previous week. Hey, what happened this past week? What worked? What didn't work? What's coming up on this next week? What do I need to prepare for? Review my schedule. And then I ask myself the most important question I ask myself within this time is I ask, what would a great husband, what would a great father, what would a great leader do over this next week? And that sets my mind to a level of expectation that I can live into to behave the way that I desire to behave. And then every day I have, and this ready, this the threes were almost too much on this. I just want to be clear. This takes me about 3 minutes. is I have a statement written out. And I didn't steal this because he offered it up, but I'll just say stole because it's more fun of a word, from Craig Groeschel, and he has gave the idea that I had never heard before of daily affirmations. And it's just key statements of, hey, this is what I'm focused on. This is who I am. This is who God has created me to be, to make sure that I'm living the level that I have been created to be and not the stress that is coming in that moment. And then I just have a couple key questions that I ask myself at the end of the day. So for me, personal rhythms. And I'm not giving you, hey, this is my life. This is what I said. This is just some activities within there. I have 3 days annually. I have 3 hours monthly. I have 30 minutes weekly. And I have 3 minutes daily to ensure that I am living a life that is intentional, that's based upon design and not just the pressure of life.
That's so very valuable, right? I mean, mm-hmm. That's extremely valuable. I don't think... I don't want to speak for everybody, but even those that are leading anything probably aren't setting up that – they're not that strategic. But the key thing to remember here is that you, Kevin mm-hmm. Jack, your personal rhythm has a huge impact on the success of the team that you're leading. When you're talking about the annual and the monthly and the weekly and the daily, of those four different – rhythms that you are participating in, what's the absolute one that you cannot do without?
For me, honestly, it's the weekly.
Okay.
It is. I can skip the daily. I can skip a daily and I'm good. I used to not do the annual just because I didn't have an opportunity and my kids were too young at the time mm-hmm. that was just too much stress and strain on our family. But I could say, honestly, I have for 15 years now spent 30 minutes every week. And that for me has been the backbone behind all this.
I want to, for me personally, I want to get to the, to have all that. The daily is something that I actually do now.
Awesome.
But the monthly is not there and the annual there. The weekly, I would say mostly is there. But for me, like, I want to know that this day counts.
Mm-hmm.
That this day matters. And not just for me.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not living this life for me. It used to be who I was living it for.
Yeah.
Right? But this life is no longer mine.
Mm-hmm.
And so that I get up with that intentional purpose of, hey, today is the day I do A, B, or C. And I consult God, and he gives me a clear direction almost all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I heard something the other day that order determines priority. You know what I mean? Or priority determines order.
Yeah.
And so that always
what
helps.
I do first determines what matters most.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. And so that's awesome. I love that. For someone out there, they need to know that maybe that weekly is the thing they set in their rhythm.
And
because
that's
they're not
going to
do them all.
Yeah. And one of the phrases, the monthly is the one that falls off sometimes just because I can't handle it. I just sometimes can't manage fitting it in my schedule. That's the one that keeps me ahead and really proactive.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why it's in there. But one of the phrases, if this is helpful for remember, is to divert daily, withdraw weekly, abandon annually.
That's great.
Every day you're diverting your mind from the rush to what matters most. You're withdrawing from the pressure of the week every single week. And every year annually, you are abandoning your tasks and responsibilities to get away to elevate your thinking.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head with the monthly and it keeping you proactive. Of all the things that I need to get better at, it would be the monthly rhythm to realize. Cause we talk about leaders, they're like, well, I didn't see this coming.
Yeah.
I didn't see this coming.
Oh,
you know what I mean? Like, and if they had this in place, they may be more likely to see that coming.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that. That is one of the most important pieces of the annual is you are able to see where I'm headed
mm-hmm.
and how are these areas of my life working? Because sometimes the areas of our life, like it is like a train wreck about to happen and everyone else can see it coming. But for some reason, you're not thinking at that level.
And the key is, too, that you sometimes can't stop that train from coming, but you know what to do when it comes because you set yourself up.
That's good.
I love that. Let's talk about organizational rhythms. So you do a weekly staff chapel and you have staff meetings. Talk about those.
Yeah. So some of our organizational rhythms, and if you're not leading in the church context, I'll give you all the ones we have. Some of them will be helpful. Some of them will only be as helpful within the church context. If you're running a business, you're probably not having staff chapel within there. So
you could.
You could. So these are some of our organizational rhythms that we have here at Be Hope. Is every Monday we have staff chapel. It's a chance for us to sing, to worship together, to share wins of good things that happen, and to develop and learn together with a specific focus on faith. And we found that that does far more to align our staff than just having a routine staff meeting. We used to run that as an all-staff staff meeting, and then we just went, man, this isn't beneficial at all. Then on top of that, we have some regularly scheduled meetings. And we don't have our regularly scheduled meetings based upon surrounded by teams. We have our regularly scheduled meetings around conversations that we know we need to continuously have. And I think that's a significant shift for most people. Instead of going, so most people, what they do is they have a regularly scheduled meeting based upon tasks and saying, what do we need to do? And just want to be clear, like, those meetings suck. Like, that is so boring. If you're just meeting, go, okay, what do we need to do? And some of that is a necessary evil, but goodness, those meetings should be 15, 30 minutes tops. If you're spending an hour on task delineation, I mean, no, thank you. I'll go work somewhere else. Mm-hmm. But to have meetings going, what do we need to continuously talk about to keep moving forward in the future? I'm excited about that. I'm pumped about any meeting that has to do with the future and where we're headed. And so that's how we shape our rhythm of staff meetings, is based upon the conversations we need to have. So when I'm leading a meeting, I will continuously tell people, this is the conversation we will continuously be having. These are the things we're going to continuously look at, but this is what we need to be talking about. So those are two key ones within there. Within our organization, another massive one, there's a ton of rhythms that we have, honestly. But one of the massive things that we do is for individual staff that I'm really proud of, the rhythms that we've established, is every quarter we get away with our team and set a focus at every campus, and we answer the question that comes out of the book, Four Disciplines of Execution. What one thing, if elevated, would make the greatest impact to our organization, would move us forward the most? Not what matters most, not what's weakest, not what's strongest, what one thing, if significantly elevated. And so we set a focus for the quarter for our entire team. And then every individual staff member will set quarterly goals in light of that quarterly focus. Some of them will be things that just pertain to their area of ministry individually. Some of them will be things, they should be things that contribute to the overall team goal to make sure we get to where we want to go. And then we have weekly one-on-one meetings with our staff. Every single person who gets a paycheck has a weekly one-on-one. And that weekly one-on-one is to ensure, secondarily, that they are aligned with their goals and making progress. But more important than that is that they're doing well, that they're healthy, that they feel purpose in the work that they have. And it's easy for us individually to lose track of the purpose. And so I think one of the best thing anyone who's in a management role can do is to continuously remind people of the purpose. And then the last one is a rhythm that we've just developed recently. And I thought this was going to be met with gnashing of teeth and much frustration, but it's actually been well, is I have every single staff person who receives a paycheck at Be Hope. They email me every day they work, and I say, give me one or two sentences. Don't give me anything more than that, because I don't have time to read more than that. How did they move the mission forward?
Yeah.
And the reason why I instituted that practice is I wanted to ensure, not that I didn't want it to be a checkup on their work. That wasn't like a, tell me how great you are to make sure that you're not at risk in terms of your job security.
Right.
Is I wanted to make sure that we were thinking in terms of outcome and not activity. And so for me, it was a rhythm that changed how we thought and not simply what we did, because I didn't want us to get focused on, so say like this, if someone sends me an email and says, how did I move the mission forward? And their response is, I held a small group leader training. That's the activity. That's not the outcome. You developed a specific skill within these small group leaders that would set them up for success. That's the outcome within there. And I wanted to ensure that we are always thinking in terms of outcomes. So those are some of our organizational rhythms.
Yeah, the one that you mentioned there, the weekly staff chapel, you know, I don't know before you if they had that in place or if it was anything that we currently have. But even if it's it doesn't matter the organization that you're leading right now, the way that we have designed that time is some of the best time to get your week going.
Yeah.
For whoever you are. Because you said two things. It's conversational and it's participatory.
Mm-hmm.
Like we come in there. And so if you're a leader and your meetings is, hey, I'm going to talk for half an hour and you're going to listen, you're not going to get very good results.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
If you walk in and you actually have the people in the room participating in the actual meeting and discussion, they have the buy-in to do whatever is necessary to get the job done. I love the meeting. I think it's a great time. It gets them, you know, it's a Monday morning. It used to be Tuesday morning. We moved it to Monday morning. But anyone who's leading, get the people to participate in the discussion and watch how your meetings change.
Yep. Yep. That's great.
I love that. And then you talked about, again, the you said the offsite for the quarterly focus. We had talked about the yearly thing. You're just taking – I love this because you're taking rhythms – the other sections of the podcast, and those rhythms that set up these other rhythms.
Yeah.
Talk more about that. Talk about how some of these rhythms become – they compound themselves, and you're able to do more with less.
So think of it from the standpoint of whenever anyone thinks of – like if we spell out all the leadership rhythms we have here, people are like, oh, my gosh, that's so much. How do you get any work done? Is it go – well, I mean, being aligned is the vast majority of the work.
Right.
And if you would think of it in a church context, think of how much time we spend towards content creation in the church of planning services and how little time we spend in terms of leadership.
Right.
There you go. It's no wonder why most churches don't go anywhere when they neglect the leadership work so significantly. And so it's not like in the same way that I talk about my personal rhythms of, hey, daily, weekly, monthly, annually – We have rhythms within our leadership as a church. Our rhythms are simply weekly, quarterly, annually. And when you set it up in that path, you ensure that long-term goals are always tied towards short-term behaviors and tasks.
Yeah, that's great. I love the question that you asked to the, how did I move the mission forward? Not what did I do?
Yep.
You know, we're all doing stuff. Everybody's doing something. As we talk right now, somebody's doing something. But what you do actually matters, and does it move the mission
forward? My favorite part is that I have actually gotten the responses because our staff is honest. Like, we know, like, don't blow smoke.
Right.
Like, absolutely. And I've gotten some responses just going, you know what? I don't actually think I did.
Yeah.
Which to go, like, my goodness, that was already happening. Like, I'm not upset when I get that response.
No, of course not.
I'm upset if I get that response 7 days in a row. Sure. But to go... the reality is that was already happening and you didn't realize it.
Yep.
But now that you're forced to answer this question because it's now part of your rhythm, you're better.
Yep, that's great. And then the last thing with the last 3 minutes that we have here, let's talk about rhythms that you set for your family.
Okay, so I won't take long on this one because we don't have long because 20 minutes to get better as a leader.
That's it.
Make it count.
Make it count.
Some simple ones we have. As a family, we take 2 trips a year. We take a trip with our family and a trip just Bethany and myself, and that happens every single year. We used to not have the financial means to do that, and so Bethany and I would find a way to get away for a night or something like that. And that's just massively helpful just to break out of the typical rhythm and hectic pace of our lives and just to be together. Some of the simple rhythms we have is I know I don't want to be out more than 3 nights a week. And as much as possible, I will guard that of saying I want to be home. I want to be with my family at least 4 nights a week. And I know other people who have said it far more than that, and I just can't do that. Like, we've got meetings that creep into the evenings. But I say one of those, I want to be just with my family and kids at home. And so there's at least 1 night a week that we say, hey, this is family night. We're hanging out. We're playing games. We're doing something together. No one's off up in their bedroom by themselves. We're developing that time together as a family. Another really simple rhythm that we have as a family is church.
Yeah.
And I know pastors who are incredibly, and I'm not saying this necessarily in a bad way, who are so protective of the amount of time that their kids are at church. I go, man, I don't see it as a danger. I see it as a blessing.
Yeah.
And I say that from my own experience. I grew up and I lived at church. Mm-hmm. And so like Sunday morning, my 7-year-old comes with me at 6:30 in the morning to serve.
Yeah.
Every Sunday. She loves it. Like we could ground her from friends' houses, TV, everything else. But if we ground her from going Sunday morning early, that's when she loses it. That's when she's the most upset. And so we have just set a rhythm as a family that church is something we do together. We talk about it as a positive and never a negative. We talk about it as a blessing and a privilege. And I remind my kids all the time, hey, because you are a pastor's kid, this is what you get to be a part of. Because you're a pastor's kid, This is what you get to be involved in and what you get to see and the people you get to know that not everyone else gets to. But those are just some of the simple rhythms that shape our family life.
That's awesome. Well, we'll leave it right there. What a fantastic review of all the different things that we've talked about in this rhythm series. We're so thankful that you guys continue to join us every week. It's been so exciting to hear your stories and how it's helping you. We know it's helping us as we're standing and sitting here right now. So every week when you guys share this, it's been a blessing to us, and we hope it's a blessing to you. Make sure you rate and review. And remember, everyone has 20 minutes to become a better leader. Make it count. We'll see you back next week. Have a great day.